All right, those of you who know me are used to me wearing a geek hat that says detection and classification on it. Today I'm going to wear a different geek hat on it. It's going to talk about what do we do after we have detections and localizations and classifications. So this is a very large project. We're collaborating with all of the NOAA Regional Fisheries Science Centers. We're also collaborating with people at Scripps, a couple of whom in the room. Anna is here, if not, I'll try to for sneaking off. John's here. And I don't think I've seen any of the NOAA people working with here today. Anyway, there's the basic problem that we have is there's lots and lots of passive acoustic monitoring data that's coming in. And you can pick your favorite instrument, whether it's our harps or pop-ups or ears or any of the cable observatories, regardless of what it is, we have lots of data coming in. And one of the things that I've been looking at is how do you take that data and automatically extract things from it, whether it be taking a look at detecting whistles from delphinids or looking at echolocation clicks or any of these types of things, how do we pull that out? Well, we've made some progress in that area. The problem isn't solved, but there's a lot of groups out working out there, and I think in the last 10, 15 years, there's been a lot of progress in that area. Well, that leads to another problem, and the problem is that after we've done all of these detections, classifications, and localizations, what do we do with it? How do we get some science out of it? And how do we keep it from becoming this avalanche of things that we don't know where anything is, we don't know what we're going to do? So that basically forces us to start taking a look at how do we organize this. All right, now this is a database problem, and it's a little bit different than your standard database because each researcher has their own things they're looking at. So, you know, if you've got somebody taking a look at monkey whale blings or something like that, somebody might be interested in, say, looking at the interpulse interval. Somebody else might be interested in beginning and ending frequencies. There's lots of characteristics that you could possibly be looking at. So we have to build a database that's flexible enough to capture things that are kind of standardized so that, you know, other people can use it. Hopefully we don't want to, you know, build this in isolation, but also flexible enough that each researcher can put in their own flavor of what's the problems that they're interested in. So there's a lot of other aspects of that. That's not really what I'm here to talk about today. What I'm here to talk about today is how we take this database and integrate it with other data sources. So our vision for this is basically each research center has their own little copy of a database where they're putting in their own information, their network, so we can share with each other and things like that. We want to be able to publish things to, say, OBC maps, you have summary data. But where the real power of this comes in is being able to integrate other data sources. So an example that I'm going to show you is with ephemeris, taking a look at things like sunrise, sunset, moon phase, that type of thing. But there's lots of habitat data and other types of geophysical data that we really want to get to too, and that was really my problem. So let me show you an example of what you can do when you have something set up. So this is about 2 years and 3 months worth of data from one particular site where harp is moored in Southern California. Now, if you take a look across the bottom, there's a little axis, and on the left, far left, it says 0, on the right, it says 24. This is 24 hours in a day, and this is all representing local time. That big white hourglass type shape you see is daylight. Off on the sides, you see some dark things. That's where we have nighttime. And then we have these light blue stripes that you may or may not be able to see in the back that basically shows where we don't have instruments recording. But these very dark blue lines that I'm gonna shout. Can everybody hear me back in the back? Okay. So these dark blue lines right here are where we have echolocation clicks. So these are where rhesus dolphins are doing something, like maybe hunting. And if you look at this for a little bit, one of the things that you'll see is that these echolocation clicks are appearing very frequently where there's no moonlight. This orange information that you're seeing right here is basically showing us the moonlight. So there's questions about, you know, what's happening? Why aren't they echolocating when there's no moonlight? Okay? When there is moonlight. And Paul Netchigil suggested to me that, well, maybe it's because they see really well. Maybe they're going someplace else. But we don't know. These are the types of questions we want to answer. And when you have a database like this, and you can look at things over, you know, a two-year period, you can start thinking about these and seeing these types of patterns. So that's kind of the strength of what we're trying to do here. Okay? Now, The problem that I had was when I started taking a look at bringing in some of this other data, habitat data, that type of thing, there were lots of different interfaces for it, and then the information was all in lots of different places. So, you know, that plot that I generated, it was a lot of work to get the data itself. But once we had the data in the database, it took about 10 minutes to generate that. And any of you who have ever done any of that type of stuff on your own know it would have taken a lot more than 10 minutes to do. But we want to be able to do that same type of thing for other data sources, like looking at chlorophyll A or any of the other types of things that you might want to do, sea surface temperature, looking at ocean fronts. And we were very fortunate in that last time when we were here, there was the ERDAP group, which is led by Roy Mendelson, gave a presentation. And they were talking about an interface that was essentially developed to help us do that. Now, for me personally, I loved the meeting last year. There was a lot of really neat stuff here. But I loved that presentation most, not because it was perhaps the most exciting, but because it saved me about 8 to 10 months worth of work. And that is a real joy, you know, for any of us, for those of us who want to use it, for those who have to do it. It was a very nice thing. So that's basically what I wanted to point out, is that I think this meeting is great because it brings together lots of people from different disciplines. I probably would have found out about the ERDAP project eventually anyway, but this was just a really nice way to do it. So I'd also like to thank all the people who have been involved in this project. There's a lot of people who've been at Scripps who've been doing a lot of the detections and classifications, running software, that type of thing, doing data collection, and also, of course, the people who fund this. This project is funded by NOF, basically on our phone, and the Navy has paid for a lot of our data collection. So, you know, thank you guys. We really appreciate it. And thank you, Pacific Light, because you made my life a lot easier.
Well, good afternoon. I'm Alex Caceres with the Coastal Dolphin Online Catalog, or CDOC as we call it. And I'm going to be very brief. This is a project that was came from this very meeting from the Southern California Marine Mammal Workshop. It's a collaboration and data sharing program and supported by Pacific Life Foundation. Hosted presently by Duke University's OGIS CMAP program, and with data contributed by many researchers representing multiple organizations. And the data is sighting histories and photo ID of coastal tercyops, bottlenose dolphins, for California coast and northern Baja. The objective of this project is to provide a digital photo ID database that's available via OGIS CMAP, and to make that database available for use by researchers, by scientists who are studying the coastal bottlenose dolphin along California and the northern Baja coastline. Just a quick timeline. In 2010, there were discussions about research with coastal bottlenose dolphins. Then in 2011, there was a data sharing and collaboration session here at the workshop. And we have we had a call emanating from that session to put together a coastal catalog that would include many of the researchers that are involved. For example, we have several of them here: Madalena Biarzi, Dave Weller, Greg Campbell, Amy Lang, R.H. Dufran, Dennis Kelly, and others that have been involved in contributing data to this project. At present, we have about just shy of 700 dolphins identified in the database at Duke. And so we launched that database version in early 2012, and we've been expanding the contributors. Hopefully, I think we'll see in 2013 we have a few data sets, newer data sets lined up to go into the database. And we had a great meeting with some additional contributors in December of 2012, and we had a very nice meeting today with a group of people. I think we'll have some new data contributions coming in from us new people. So at present for 2013, we're looking at some data refinements, updating the images. Some of the older images that were originally slides are now in digital format, but still need a bit of work. Working on uploading, I think we have about 3 data sets in the pipeline right now and hopefully more coming soon. We're working on some web-based communications. At present, that looks like it would probably be a web forum for the researchers who are involved with the project. And we're engaging discussions with new contributors, so looking for those people who have data collections that they would contribute for this purpose. And so with that, I just want to say thank you very much to Pacific Life Foundation, and thank you, Bob and Tennyson. Thank you to the Duke University OBA-CMAP program, and thank you very much to our CDOC collaborators.
Hi, I'm Monica DeAngelis, and I'm going to give a very brief update on a session we had last year entitled Marine Mammals and Fisheries Partnering for Better Management, and I have some props. In the 2011 Southern California Marine Mammal Workshop, participants voted that fisheries interactions were one of the greatest threats to marine mammals, and that was the impetus to get the session going last year. And I encourage you to go back and look at the videos online to really hear what happened there. But the panel, I thought, gave a very good, well-rounded review of issues related to marine mammals and fishery interactions. As the group discussed the issues raised by the panel, it became quite evident that there was a need to foster more formal and informal avenues of communication between scientists, regulators, and particularly the fishing community. And the group recognized very many benefits in working together. So since that time, in fact, pretty soon thereafter, and maybe because it was still fresh in the scientific community's mind, we had a pretty spectacular year of large whale entanglements. Ramped up in March, and I use this sort of jokingly, sort of slowed down in June. This scientific community, again, and the stranding networks, disentanglement teams, U.S. Coast Guard, the public played an integral role in as a resource in aiding into the response. But of course, there can always be improvement. Since then, we've also sponsored, NOAA has sponsored 2 disentanglement trainings, one in August and one in September, that was in Northern California and one in Southern California, and many of you attended. And we had many folks from outside of this community who are now coming in that aren't necessarily scientific researchers per se, but have now joined in that effort, so that's great. A DVD has also been created. The DVD is entitled The Guide for Ocean Users, The Role You Can Play, and we hope to distribute that shortly and hopefully encourage some of you all to take that. Maybe Bernardo can blast it to his 1,000-plus people on Facebook. We can get people worldwide. We've also been working with our fellow colleagues in Mexico since we know that there's some fishing practices down there. We've had a lot of entangled gray whales coming up north, and we've reached out to them as well. So we all appreciate that as we've done. Of course, you know, these disentanglements are just a band-aid to the actual issue at hand, so obviously there's still more work to be done. A fixed gear guide, some of you have seen this floating around, has been created and it's been used by folks like the California Department of Fish and Wildlife Game, or whatever they're now called, to educate folks, and it's aiding in the identification of the gear that we're finding on these animals, which is also helping us to target what fisheries and what folks we want to reach out to and foster those relationships to. We've also had other folks come about and put some stickers together with a disentanglement number, a distress number, and Magdalena's put that out too. So all of these folks are coming together, giving out the same message, which is extremely encouraging. There was also a co-occurrence work has been done by Lauren Seiss of our National Fisheries Service office here in Long Beach, and a publication will soon come out. And again, that's another way that we're looking at particular fisheries that we may want to talk to the fishermen themselves to get them involved and potentially minimizing the risk to large whales. Of course, there's many unknowns regarded to whale entanglement, so I encourage folks to think about their own research and how that could play into that. Removal of gear in the water through marine debris programs is continuing, and we should also support those efforts as well. Shifting gears a little bit, there's been a lot of work on pinnipeds, also with regard to interactions with fisheries. It's been a little over a 3-year effort, but there's a collaborative research effort underway with the University of California, Los Angeles, and local fishing community and NIMS, We are working together to look at a new non-lethal deterrence device to deter seals and sea lions while folks are actively fishing and hopefully reduce the bycatch and interactions with those animals. There's also an effort looking at the halibut trawl fishery to investigate any gear modifications. So again, working with the fishing community, since they are the ones that know their gear the best, and we know the animals the best. So there's been quite a lot of work that's been done. The reality is that it's still based on individuals reaching out to individuals, and I think that's fine. We're making progress. The result of last year's workshop was that we need to foster relationships, and I would encourage folks to continue to do that. So as I look out at this community, it's been truly amazing. And I leave you with a couple of quotes from John Wooden, who said that don't measure yourself by what you've accomplished, but what you should have accomplished with your ability, because you cannot do, but because what you cannot do should not interfere with what you can do. And so I'd like to thank Pacific Life for continuing to inspire us to continue to improve our work and our work together.